So this is going to be quite interactive. The microphone will not roam. The audience will roam to the microphone, and you're welcome to move to the microphone whenever you have a question you'd like to raise or a point you'd like to make. But before we do that, we're going to start at the panel. There are three of us. I'm not one of those three. On my right, Ortvin Wren. On my left, John Graham. And on his left, Hans Peter Meister. I'm going to ask them in that order to introduce themselves and their interest in the role of evidence in risk decision making.
Well, thank you very much, Chris, for this introduction. The issue of what evidence means in regulation is one that has preoccupied my thinking and my reflections about risk governance for quite a time. One of the issues we're facing is that not only values are contested in modern society, but also knowledge, and even more so than in previous times, and that we have different science camps, different scientific assumptions about aspects of risk and of regulation, and that this pluralism of knowledge claims is one that regulators face, and there are quite a set of different answers to this. And I think there are two ideal type of answers, or two extremes. The one is extreme is delegate all the issues of evidence to a set of well-articulated and well-educated experts and have them resolve all factual issues. And the other extreme is that's what I would call the postmodern view, which is any language is created equal and any knowledge is created equal. So it doesn't matter whether it's expertise or perception. The main thing is that there are claims, and we'll just try to find the ones that find the highest consensus among those who are affected by the decision process. So between these two extremes, I think we need to find the right way. Why are these extremes a problem? The first problem is that specifically in regulatory decision making, we're talking about issues that have a high degree of what we have called complexity, uncertainty, and ambiguity. Complexity means that there are a lot of intervening variables. They're between A and B, between cause and effect. They're not an obvious relationship, but very often a lot of intervening variables. So that's even for scientists very difficult to make robust and clear claims between A and B. Secondly, which is a resulting part of this, is that we are uncertain about some of the claims that we make about the connection between A and B, and that we also are very uncertain about regulatory options, whether they are effective, whether they are efficient, whether they are fair. So all kinds of criteria that we have developed to evaluate various regulatory impacts. Again, those are uncertain in the way we don't exactly know what they're doing, and we have good educated guesses, sometimes models, sometimes not more than opinions. And lastly, we have ambiguity, which means that even if we do agree on the complexity, even if we do agree on the characterization of the uncertainty, it may mean a different thing to different people. For one, the glass is half full, for the other one is half empty. And even if it's exactly the same fact, we still have very different interpretations about it, specifically what we should do about it, whether it's acceptable, tolerable, or not. So given this kind of problem that the evidence is always contested, or very often contested, that it's uncertain, that it's also fairly complex, the idea of just delegating factual decision to an elite of scientists is probably not working. First, depending on which scientist you ask, you might get different answers. Secondly, if you ask one set of scientists, you may get a lot of opposition from other scientists, or even from other groups in society who claim to have superior knowledge. So this thing is the way that will probably lead to some kind of a problem. And the second major element, which I said is a relative sense of science, a constructivist view, is that there is no real rule, there's no criteria how to judge the quality of factual evidence, would lead us to a total relative world in which, you know, factual evidence has no meaning whatsoever. And of course, you know, if you're talking about regulation that very often is about life and death of people, that's not an acceptable way. So the real question is there a way that avoids the relativism on one hand side and the kind of positivistic realism on the other side? And what we try to do also with the risk governance framework was to define a way that science is still plural and evidence is plural, but not arbitrary. So to say, yes, there are limits, there are boundaries between the absurd and the possible, between the possible and the probable, and between the probable and the certain. And maybe those distinctions are very helpful terms for regulatory purposes, because it can tell the regulators things that are clearly impossible or absurd or close to fantasy. There were things that are possible, but we don't have a way to really calculate their probabilities. There are things where we can calculate probabilities either on a Bayesian or some other method, and there are things we're pretty certain about them. And to make that distinction already extremely helpful, and we need to have that input into a specific discourse, of course, epistemic discourse, a discourse in which these kinds of demarcation lines are being set. And once they're set, then we can still live as a kind of a plurality of different scientific input, but again, those factual claims have a border to the right and to the left where it becomes ludicrous. And I think that's very important to see those borders and to find processes, and I will talk later about this maybe during the discussion, on how these processes could be generated to make these very crucial distinctions.
Thanks, Wolfram. John.
Good afternoon. My training is in decision analysis and cost-benefit analysis at Carnegie Mellon University. I was on the faculty at the Harvard School of Public Health for 17 years, where I taught physicians and nurses how to do cost-effectiveness analyses of medical technologies and public health practices. From 2001 to 2006, I served as a political appointee in the Bush administration, overseeing the conduct and practices of the federal regulatory agencies of the United States, as well as their information and statistical practices. I'm currently the Dean of the Indiana University School of Public and Environmental Affairs. I have a special interest in this topic because in the United States, I have participated in the development of a formal guidance document called OMB Guidance on Information Quality and Peer Review, which is now the established procedures for how U.S. agencies define evidence for use in rulemaking.
John, just to follow up the OMB guidance, could you perhaps link that to how you might define evidence?
I can. Would you like our...
Just to clarify that one.
Okay, yes. Well, in the information quality area, we use the word information rather than evidence. And the guidelines that we have two key components. The first is a presumption of validity for evidence which has been peer-reviewed according to specified standards for peer review. And those standards involve selection of experts, documentation of their activity, and the transparency with which the results of that peer review are open to the public. And you can read about that in OMB's peer review bulletin, which is on the White House website. The second criteria, the peer review criteria creates a presumption of validity, but even peer-reviewed evidence can be overturned by particular types of demonstrations of invalidity or unreliability. And the second requirement is replicability. Replicability is defined particularly relative to data or modeling results, where it must be possible for a qualified scientist with adequate resources to replicate the finding or the modeling result. Notice that I did not say replicated. I said replicable or capable of being replicated. which means there must be sufficient transparency about research design and modeling so that another scientist could, in principle, if the effort were made, generate that replication. It does not require that the result actually be replicated. So I hope that's a start, Chris, on what we would mean by evidence in U.S. rulemaking.
Oh, that's great. Thanks very much, John. That's Peter.
Yeah, thank you. Why am I here today? Actually, I don't know, since you didn't make the introduction, and I would be curious to find out, but I have an assumption. I'm not a scientist, so I'm somehow untypical for the round and for this event here also, but I'm a practitioner, and I'm always dealing with a question in my daily life of how do we deal in practice with the recommendations of the scientists that that you give to us, and what is really sellable on the market? Because EFOC is a consultancy. We have a little bit more than 100 consultants in Europe and the US, and what we do in our daily work is to find out what evidence-based policy will be paid off by our clients. So we have a certain criteria for success because we have to find somebody who pays for some tools, and I want to explain a little bit about our experiences in the past, what were really the commercially successful tools that we could apply, and perhaps we can also discuss how they differed from what you scientists recommended us to do. I was also asked why is the topic that we chose today is close to my heart, so how that is how it was put. And I must say that I'm an ecologist by training, and I was always very moved by the experience that we, as in that time, ecologic scientists, thought that we know exactly what needs to be done. But when we looked at the decision-making processes in our society, we found out that it was by far not realized what we suggested as ecologists. So the question I was moved very much in my professional life was, how can we really change a society? What is it? What do we have to do to implement solutions that we found to be valuable or to be true? And our answer we found is participation. So I'm here also as a participation specialist, and so my answer to the question that is posed here by the organizers, my answer will be that evidence-based policymaking, to my opinion, must be participatory for a broader and deeper knowledge, for more transparency, and for legitimacy of the decision process. So far to the question, why is the topic close to my heart? And so the third question I want to address, what are the major challenges that I see or that I will focus in this debate today here? And I think that I can say at least in Europe or continental Europe, we have seen three phases of participatory policymaking in the last years. The first phase, I would say, was the experimental phase, but all the solutions more or less that we proposed more or less didn't work. So that was the first phase. The second phase now was a more successful phase. We developed tools how to really implement participation into decision making, and it was successful. We produced solutions, some stakeholders bought into that solutions, the parliaments accepted that, but now we have the problem that, and that will be the third phase, we have to deal with the question, how can the administration really accept participation tools in their decision processes? How are the incentives that we need for bureaucracy and administrations to use the advantages of participation processes? So that you will see here in our debate here, I will focus on joint fact-finding methods, participatory joint fact-finding methods, and I want to show you also with some examples how we did that and what the implications for the future might be.
Thank you. Well, that's got us started. I've now got the opportunity basically to pose questions without really much pre-warning to the three people up here. So bear with us because we haven't got a crib sheet to work from, although we've got a few thoughts. The The thing that has come to my mind immediately, and that's partly framed by the fact that I was in this same room in the last session, is that there's a link, and the link essentially is changing behavior. Whether it's through regulation or other means, what one is seeking to do is change a behavior. And I'd like to turn to you, Ortwin, because you're probably closest to understanding what it takes to change behavior and why, and how to motivate people, and perhaps looking on what evidence people themselves use if they are to change.
Well, thank you, Chris. Well, this is a very, of course, difficult, very important question. So if you were to know exactly what changes people's behavior, I think we probably would not sit here. We would all have a very well-paid consulting company. I think then, if you look more general, there are kind of five different ways in which human behavior can be influenced, and evidence is only one. Evidence builds upon the incentive that through knowing the insights and the consequences of your own behavior, you adjust your behavior to the consequences that you would like to gain. That's basically the philosophy of decision analysis, that you say you have various options, you ask yourself what are the consequences of these options. You need expertise to know what these options are because they are not obvious very often. And if you find an option where you believe that the consequences are most agreeable to your own needs or to your own goals, that's the one you would choose. Now, we know that there are other types of incentives that can change your behavior. One other incentive is a monetary incentive. You get a reward. You know, we learn a lot about learning, that learning is often connected with rewards. And their evidence is not necessary. Basically, if you do X and you get some kind either of punishment or some kind of a positive sanction, you'll do or not do this. And of course, in an interest-driven society, awards are very, very important, and it is very often irrelevant what the evidence is. A third major incentive for changing behavior is value commitment. We have in civil society a lot of groups that share specific values, specific beliefs, specific convictions. Maybe some of the environmental groups, but also religious groups, think of fundamentalism. And the change in behavior is driven by the commitment to a specific value or to a specific vision. So, you know, if you are a monk, for example, you do a lot of things that you would normally probably not do, don't marry, do all kind of other things that are probably not within your own interest because you believe that this is what God wants you to do. Or if you are very devoted environmentalist, you have these specific values and you do things because you believe that those values need to be secured. And the fourth one is the one that is obedience and force and power. We live in society where people have a different degree and differential of power, so people can tell others what to do or not to do and have the authority over changes. And we can see today, and I think that's what makes this whole issue a little bit more complex, is that none of these four, really, or five different, I forgot one, which is social bonds, that these are working by themselves. I mean, we see that just having power does not mean that people do what I want. If you have just evidence, well, we can see from many areas that that is not sufficient. If you just pay people off or punish them with, you know, rewards, that again is something which works, but very often is not sufficient again to introduce behavioral changes. And the last thing which I forgot was the social bonds, that's social relationships by which we change our behavior. And again, that may be not sufficient. So in a sense, in terms of this question of how can we make changes in people's behavior, we need to combine things. And that, of course, is difficult. We might orchestrate it sometimes, that is even more problematic. But We really have to combine saying and saying, look at climate change, for example. You have to give the evidence. You have to make sure that the monetary incentives are in place. You have to make sure that through education, kind of environmental values have become a higher value. Through authorization, doing some kind of, you know, whatever kind of legal things to make sure that people obey to specific regulations and rules, and maybe through social bonding, in which you say, well, you know, have Agenda 21 processes and other things, kind of social processes that kind of support all of this. So changes, I think, on a larger scale are only possible if you combine all these five types of incentives to some extent, and the more you can do that, the more likely you have these changes to happen. And evidence is one, but a very important element of this.
Just before we move on, Ortwin, could you perhaps share with us how those five dimensions might be impacted when the process is being put together? Because at some point, somebody's got to decide what the outcome should be. What's the behavioral change that you're looking to get? Where does that fit into, if you like, the participative process?
Well, the participative process can do two things. I mean, it can first kind of generate consensus about where to go. And I think in a plural society, we do not have the benevolent dictator who tells us what's good for us. But we have a process, an opinion-forming process in which, you know, do we want more sustainability? Do we want more X? Do we want more Y? This is a process in which participatory elements can help to generate these kind of common goals. And they may not, sometimes they're trivial, you know, we all want the good for the best, but very often we need to decide between, you know, conflicting goals. The second point of participation is really once we know what seems to be good for us, so what is the goal to accomplish, just like, for example, sustainability or financial stability, or a better health situation, that we ask ourselves, what are the ways to implement this goal? What kind of strategies do we have? What kind of instruments can we use? And very often we can see is that participation can play a major role in not just setting the goals, because very often that may be more fuzzy than we think, but rather once the goals are set, to say, how can we accomplish this goal? And that's where all these various incentives come into play, because the participatory process can help to make these various incentives either streamlined or put into effect, or that the composition of these incentives can be changed through participation depending on what works and what doesn't work. And I think there the feedback between the policy maker and the affected population is very important.
Hans-Peter, can I turn to you? Because essentially you try and make this happen, or you do make this happen. What are the essentials to achieving an agreed objective and then working out how it's going to get there, how people are going to get there?
Yeah, the biggest problem starts at the beginning, of course, because as Ortwin already mentioned, it's not really a mainstream event that a decision maker in Germany really uses participation methods in order to find a solution or in order to find out what is the evidence of his decisions he has to make. So that is, being very concrete and discussing that at the example of the Frankfurt Airport enlargement. There was in 1999, Lufthansa suddenly, out of the blue, said, for the politicians at least, said that they needed a new runway. And of course, all environmentalists denied that and said, no, we don't need another runway. The economic importance of the airport is not there, and also the people in the area will be noise polluted. So don't build a new runway. So what do you do as a decision maker in such a situation, a governor? If you say, well, it's a good point that Lufthansa really mentioned that, and I really don't know what the answer is to that, and now I will start a mediation process to find out, or a dialogue process to find out, you know, within the discussion of many experts whether Lufthansa is true or the NGOs are true or something like that, that will be immediately interpreted as a weakness of the politician, of the governor. So that is one reason why the media will ask, well, he doesn't know what to do, or doesn't know what is important, what kind of leader do we have? So we don't have in our society not the picture of a leader who wants to be a good, who wants to have a good consultancy, or who wants to have a decision preparation with dialogue of different experts. So that's the first thing. But even so, if our governor, let's assume our governor says, I don't care about the media for whatever reasons, so I'll just decide what I think is the best. Then he or she immediately has the question, who do you ask? What kind of expert do you ask? And now going back to the airport example, of course, immediately after the discussion started, we had all different kind of expertise. And for example, the question of how many people in the area were noise polluted by a new runway, we had three different expertises of three different very well-known academic professors who came to the conclusion that about 12 to 18,000 people would be noise polluted in addition to the already existing noise pollution in the area. So our governor, if he had believed that, I just want to start with a story at the end or tell you the result of the end. After a two-year mediation process with a joint fact-finding procedure, we found out that it's about 300,000 instead of 12 to 18,000 people that are noise polluted in addition to the level we already have. So that's quite a difference. So the question for our governor now would be, how do I really get the best consultancy? And so we think, or the way to do that is now joint fact-finding, and we did that by several means that I can explain, asking the whole peer of scientists and having them disputed their different results with each other and not via media, so all kinds of tools that we applied here. But even though we have that result, the question now is, does the administration in Germany really accept that figures that were found in that mediation or dialogue process? And here we have the next problem. The administration does not or does not have to orient themselves on the findings of this dialogue process. Instead, we have laws at the moment that they have to do all the same procedures again. They have to ask the same experts again. They produce the same results, but in most of the time. But the administration is somehow out of this procedure of deliberation because it's not somehow regulated by law in Germany. So, to come back to the question that you rose at the moment, I would say that we really need a cultural change within administration, within political decision makers, and also in our general public, that it is not a weakness, but instead rather a strength of a decision maker to ask as much scientists, as much experts before making a decision, instead of knowing everything already when the question is asked.
John, I'm going to come to you now because for two reasons. One is you do come from a different country, and it would be interesting to get at your cultural perspective on this. But secondly, perhaps you can share with us some of the insights that you've got from your time at OMB. For example, I understand that the EPA has itself got to go through myriad number of consultations as part of its own processes. And I'd be wondering if you could share with us how novel the idea of participation is, or is it a new approach that's novel?
Well, I think it's a complicated question. But let me start by saying that the idea of participation of stakeholders and the public has is well grounded in U.S. practice. Some of the things that my two colleagues are talking about here are the kinds of exercises they're talking about are sometimes used at the local level. But quite frankly, they are not very useful or commonly used in rulemaking, regulatory decisions that have a national character to them. And let me go into that. It's partly cultural and I think partly practical. In a country as diverse and as broad as ours that has, due to the explosion of philanthropy, created as many NGOs as there are cities in the country, it's not really realistic to think that you're going to design a process where identified stakeholders will be at the table and they will negotiate something out and make a recommendation. There are occasional regulatory negotiations that occur in the United States, but they represent a very tiny fraction of the regulations that are generated. What has happened is that regulators have been entrusted by our legislatures with the power to make these decisions in the public interest as they determine it and as guided by the statute that underpins their authority. And hence, this has led to the idea of evidence-based approaches to avoid arbitrary and capricious decisions on behalf of these regulators. There must be evidence that underlies it, and hence we need standards of what constitutes evidence. It would, for example, be very unwise for a regulator in the United States to delegate their power away to a group, such as the airport example, to decide the result of that issue. It would be unwise both as a matter of politics and as a matter of law. It would be unwise as a matter of politics because, in a sense, our legislature asked them or instructed them to accept the political accountability for making the decisions. That's what they're paid to do. They're the ones who should make the decisions, not these other people. And the other people are not accountable in any way in the sense that the regulator is accountable. And second of all, and maybe more importantly, legally, the idea here is that there must be evidence in the record to support the regulator's determination. Even if this group gets together and has a fancy consensus about what they want to do, it still has to meet all the same requirements of law, must be supported by evidence in the record, et cetera, et cetera. So as a practical matter, there's not a whole lot of advantage to going through a lot of that activity. There's more of a focus on having an open process where people can submit data, science, evidence, analysis, and then the regulatory body makes a decision based upon that information.
Okay, just to come back on that, when you were describing the OMB guidelines, forgive me if I'm wrong, the inference was that a single peer-reviewed, an adequate and transparent and replicable study would be sufficient. One of the issues that I think participation is seeking to address is the fact that science can be contestable. Could you say a little bit more about how that works in the U.S.?
Yes. Well, first of all, let me make a comment on the, I think, generally correct statement that there are cases where there's contested science. However, in my experience in regulatory matters, when we have what appears to be contested science, we often refer those matters to our National Academy of Sciences, which are sort of the leading recognized scientists in their fields in the United States. And I would say it's quite rare for that body to come back without a consensus statement that is not always definitive, but usually quite helpful to regulatory agencies. So I don't want people in this room to get the impression that there are a large fraction of cases where these scientists are just warring with each other. Now, there are people who say they are scientists who war with each other, and there are people who are at the fringe of their discipline, who are not necessarily a mainstream figure in their field, but those kinds of people would not necessarily have the credentials to be on a National Academy of Sciences committee. Now, my second point would be that it would be typical in a decision analysis or a cost-benefit analysis, when there is such scientific disagreement, legitimate scientific disagreement, to present an analysis of costs and benefits with two sets of assumptions, one under the assumptions of one body of scientific thought and another under the assumption, under another set of assumptions about scientific thought, and share those results with the regulator. But ultimately, the regulator has to make the call on how they're going to weigh those different kinds of analyses.
Thanks. Now, Otwin, I'm going to come back to you, and you've got no preparation for this one at all. One of the issues seems to be that scientific data is seen as fact, but data about perceptions and, shall we say, feelings about risk is not seen as fact. How is that balance going to be improved?
Well, I mean, being a social scientist, we have been trained to say that perceptions are just as facts as any other types of facts. They're just different types of, or a different category of facts. People are being driven by perceptions, and their behavior is based on perceptions. So what people do is not what is the objective world telling them, but it's basically how they perceive the objective world outside, and that perception can be biased or can be altered by all kinds of visual or informational drivers. But I think what's quite important is that if the intent of regulation is really, in the end, to make sure that the goals of whatever safety, of security, and others are being adhered to, these goals are dependent not only on the kind of factual evidence that tells you, you know, what compromises these various goals, but the behavior that have an impact on these goals, as I said, are being based on perceptions. So in terms even of knowing what are the impacts of various risks or what are the impacts of regulatory measures, you have to look at both. What are the physical impacts on one hand side, but secondly, what are the social and behavioral impacts that are based on the issue of perception? So in a sense, if you want to know what's happening, you need both. And you need very good science on the physical side, the best you can get, and I agree with John on this, it's very important to have, you know, very good quality control. But in addition, in order to make a wise decision, you have to know what the behavioral implications are. And behavioral implications, as I said, are driven by perceptions. So we need to see also the perception side, just to find out how to make wise and prudent decisions at the end point. Let me say one more thing about what John had just said about this issue of, you know, accountability. I think that's a very important issue, because it's very clear there are elected officials, the legitimate decision makers, that face charges of accountability if they do something wrong. And I certainly would oppose an element in which you just delegate power, because then also you have a diffusion of responsibility. But what I think is very well acknowledged in many of these political and regulatory fields is that people can give you input, and then we've had people, it could be stakeholders, it could also be citizens, randomly selected group, that can give you input first on what matters to them. That's the concern side which you need to know, but also, which I believe is very important, to say what are the trade-offs, because the evidence cannot tell you what to do if you have conflicting values. The evidence can only tell you how these values are affected. But if you have conflicting values, and you often have that you have to, you know, between, let's say, safety and security, you may have a trade-off. You may have a trade-off between safety and freedom. You may have a trade-off between individual public health protection and collective public health protection. Now, these trade-offs, I think, are, in a sense, demonstrations or representations of people's preferences over one or the other. They need to be informed, of course, so that's why we need participation, not just opinion polls. But given these kinds of, you know, what are the common representations of these trade-offs, that is something I think what public participation can do, and it's not replacing the official government, and it's also not undermining the authority of the regulator. And I would agree with Hans-Peter on that sense. It's not really undermining authority. Last point maybe on this issue, I've served on one of these committees of the U.S. Academy of Science, as a matter of fact, on public participation in environmental decision making. And yes, the report is unanimous, but the report basically shows a wide array of different interpretations about this, and I've seen that in many reports. So yes, I agree that it's very important to get the boundaries of legitimate decisions and of legitimate evidence. On the other hand, within those boundaries, I think the distance between the left and the right boundary is maybe a little wider than you feel it is, that there is more possibility for different types of interpretations. And I think we need to take that into account. And again, their participation can help you at least to see the representations of these legitimate differences in looking at the same evidence.
Hans-Peter, can I ask you perhaps to say a little bit of about how you go about getting these values transparent in a presumably relatively quick process, and also to say how it's done equitably, because presumably even expert opinions have some values behind them. But can you show us how people gain confidence in each other in a dialogue process?
Yeah. Classical example is you ask all the members with different interests, the conflict groups, at collecting at one table, and then ask them to suggest what kind of experts they would like to have to investigate the issue that is in conflict. So you get a pretty good sample of all the whole scientific community with different opinions, be they now legitimate in a scientific sense or not. That is not the question then at that moment. It's just everybody is able to name its own expert. So after that, you have two possibilities. You either ask them to pitch for an expertise, yeah, if it takes a little bit longer for an expertise, for written expertise, and then the group of people with all their conflicts have to have a consensus who will be the one expert who does the research, the investigation. And what is done then is we just don't have only one expert who does the research, but we have two, three, or four others from the group that do something like a quality control, like a peer review. But it's systematically starting this quality control from the beginning of the research. So they accompany their colleague from the beginning of his expertise, of his work. And that's a joint process of having an expert or experts to answer that question. And for example, we did that. I stay with one example. I can add others, but stay with the Frankfurt example so that I don't have to add others. We did that in 15 different cases, and in 98% there was no conflict afterwards with the result. So the scientists had the same opinion about the outcome, about answering the question of the group. The other possibility is to have a hearing, which is then, but very different from hearings that you usually have, because as you know, hearings in our legislative procedure usually are, you have 20 questions and you ask one expert after the other, but there is no real discussion between the experts, one hand. On the other hand, usually there is not at all the attempt at least to get the experts to formulate a consensual position. But if you do that, and again, we did that in several cases, in most of the cases, you really find a very broad consensus, even though the experts before had very conflictuous opinions. And therefore, I think I want, when John said, don't delegate the decision-making power to such a body, I completely agree. That was not the point I want to make. The regulatory body, of course, has to decide. But I think for good governance, it's important to see for us at the end who are the experts who were really considered in the decision, what where the discussion process is, and what kind of expertise really influenced afterwards the decision. To make that transparent is also a question of trust, and whether that's been done by a regulatory body who starts such a process, which is transparent, or whether it's done outside in an mediation or a dialogue process, I don't care for that. The important thing is that it's done.
Okay, can you give us an idea of how long that process takes or took in the case of Frankfurt?
Well, in the case of Frankfurt, which is, I think, the biggest case, that infrastructural project that we ever had in Europe here, that was 15 months.
15 months,
so after 15 months, you had a complete set of investigations where all conflictual partners at the table agreed on the outcomes.
Yeah,
and at least they agreed on what they disagreed as well. So, yeah.
And was that outcome the one adopted?
Pardon me?
Was that the adopted outcome?
Was the it was adopted?
Yeah.
The government of Hessen adopted it as their own position, and the parliament as well, with 94 or 93% of its members. So the legislative and the executive adopted the positions.
Okay. Another part of the previous session was a presentation by Donald McRae from the UK, and he titled his presentation, if I recall correctly, "The Politics of Risk and Regulation." John, do you think you could give me an inference, some insight into how a 15-month decision-making cycle, or in addition to a decision-making cycle, would work for people who have a four-year electoral cycle?
Let me start by reacting to a few of the comments of my colleagues, and I'll try to make this as pointed as possible to drive home the point I'm trying to make. All this discussion about the importance of understanding the perceptions of people and the opinions of stakeholders, okay? This type of thinking, okay, is what creates the problems that we have across the Atlantic Ocean in developing a marketplace for the products that are produced on both sides of the Atlantic. So for example, if it's all right for the European Commission or a member state to say, we are not going to permit any genetically modified seeds in this country, we understand that there's not any science to say that it's unsafe, but our public perceives that this is a bad idea, we are not going to have this, okay? Now, in the United States, if a regulator were to stand up and say that, they would not be sustainable in a court of law in that prohibition. There has to be evidence-based policymaking. It has to be grounded in something other than the fact that some people, even a large number of people, perceive it to be true. So, for example, the framers of the U.S. Constitution did not want to create another King of England, but they also were deeply distrustful of mass popular opinion as a guide to policy, and they designed the U.S. Constitution to make it very difficult for mass popular opinion to control the outcomes of the U.S., ultimately the U.S. regulatory process. So this goes back to my point, we're not looking for perceptions, we're not looking for opinions, we're looking for evidence that can be validated, that can be peer-reviewed, that can be replicable. Is this only physical facts? No. A basic point of economics is we need data on preferences. Economics is the study of human preferences in choice, real choice situations. And we want that evidence in cases, not when they just certainly perceive certain things, when they are well-informed, and when they've had the opportunity to deliberate on the impacts on themselves and their family. And it's those kinds of studies of preferences, many of them reviewed in Ortwin's book on this subject, that are important in the rulemaking process. But just what happened to people, just what people think when they answer a survey or an opinion poll, that is not relevant. Because in economics, we want informed, idealized preferences that reflect reflection. So to get back to the fundamental point again, we need to keep our eye on the ball of what evidence-based policymaking is, because if we don't, we're going to simply allow different countries of the world to do whatever they want to do, and then they can say, we're doing it that way because of perceptions. And of course, the World Trade Organization cannot possibly function in that kind of an environment. There must be some evidence to support what these people are doing.
Can I ask you to say a little bit more about evidence? And I know this is a hobby horse as well, so I know this might take you more than a couple of minutes. When you were in office, you were quite critical of applications of the precautionary approach or principle in Europe. And GMs was just one subject. Now, you talked there about evidence. If I'm not mistaken, even the precautionary principle itself cannot be invoked without there being some evidence. So what did you see going on from the other side?
Well, I think that quite obviously the concern that we had in the U.S. government was that, and this is true of U.S. policymakers as much as European policymakers, if your underlying agenda is to pursue an economic interest, or say a protectionist sentiment with regard to your own country, you would not announce that as your objective and then proceed to implement in that fashion. You would seize upon evidence of either that you are doing on behalf of the people what your people want, or you will manufacture scientific evidence to suggest that this supports what you want. And believe me, on occasion, we in the U.S. government engage in this behavior, and I'm not recommending it, okay? But we do need, I think, at least as a matter of principle, to at least aspire to a process where we would expect that people would refer to evidence. Now, the precautionary principle creates this problem for us because in my dialogue with the European Commission and my reading of the February 2000 communication, they're still not willing to actually define what they mean by the precautionary principle, when in fact I have read the literature enough to know that, for example, Professor Sandin in Sweden has documented 34 different definitions of the precautionary principle in different treaties and in conference presentations and academic writings. Well, I can assure you the U.S. government is not prepared to sign on to something until it is defined.
Yeah, well, I mean, there are a couple of things I'd like, of course, to comment on this one, and I'm very glad that we have some really pinpointed ideas here. Number one, let me go back to the perception side. Perceptions are, as I said, just as real as anything else in the world. It is what people think about different ideas and elements and subjects and objects of this world. Now, if they think something, it doesn't mean it's true. And I did not want to infer that everything what we think is true. But what I said was that what people think is partially responsible for what they do. And actions, of course, have physical impacts. Let me give you one example. We were advising the Food Safety Standard Agency in the UK on food irradiation. And we all know that food irradiation is not very welcomed by most of the public, but you know, that's the perception side. But what was really interesting was there was first a study by a physical scientist who basically said, well, it actually prolongs shelf life, it does hygienize food, so it is actually reducing the physical risk to the consumer if we do that. Now, the Food Standard Agency then did a large survey among the British population and said, what would you do if food were irradiated? And around 60% of the people responded, well, we know this is a hygienization procedure. We don't have to put fresh food anymore in the refrigerator because we can leave it outside and we can eat it. There's no need for us to freeze or refrigerate it. Now, in the end, if that perception would have prevailed, people would be sicker than they were before. So, in a sense, even the physical impact of that perception was clear an impact that a regulator needed to know. Now, what the regulator does is something very different from considering it. It doesn't have to say, well, because people think something which is wrong, we have to accept this. They can say we do some better risk communication, or we put a label on this, or they can do all kinds of things. Or they say, well, it's probably not possible to educate the whole public to deal with it, and the benefits are so small, then we'd rather don't do it. But I think it's very important to see that the behavioral implications of perceptions have real physical impacts. So it's not that there are perceptions on one hand side, that's for people irrational beliefs, and on the other hand there's the fact that we make to have sure that the facts are coming true. It's much more that these things interact and we need to know the interactions. And that is just as factual as the interaction between the various physical compartments. Second point on preferences. I mean, our market economy is based on the issue that we can make choices. Whether they are informed or not doesn't make any difference. But those are individual choices. Now, if the German average man has 7.3 pajamas, now is that rational? Probably we could get along with three. You know, one washing, the other two in the... We all make choices in our market that have, you know, if we were well informed, we would probably not do. Now, I think the market economy is based on the idea that we do not question the choices and the preferences of each individual, and as long as that individual has the power to pay for it, we believe that it is his or her own choice to do that. And there's nobody to question this unless a third party is violated. That's something different. There are very few exceptions about drugs and something like that where we believe, because people, that's something where we believe people cannot revoke their decision. But on most sides, we do that. Now, in terms of GMOs, the best way to allocate or to resolve that problem is to label the food and say, well, if you want to buy genetically modified organisms, well, there's a label, you can do it. If you don't want to buy it, for whatever reason, it's not necessary in a market economy to give a reason why you buy or why you don't buy something. You can say, I just don't like the way that this food is produced. But the problem, of course, is you have to make sure that you have choice. And normally the market allows for choices, but sometimes you need rules and regulations that make sure that that choice is there. And the present EU regulation is basically on making sure that coexistence of genetically modified food or conventional food is given. That's not to ban things. I mean, there are some countries like Austria would like to ban it, but again, that would not be, I think, consistent with what I would advocate. Consistent is to say, we have to make sure that people have the choice between A and B, and if they prefer B for whatever reason, then we should, you know, the market should provide it, and the regulator should make sure that that choice is there. I think that's the role of the regulator here. And
just a quick comment. Professor Wren's comment on economics was an accurate description of positive economics. There's another field called normative economics and welfare economics, which are based on informed and idealized preferences, not on actual preferences as expressed in the market, unless it can be demonstrated that those are informed and are considered.
Yeah, I agree with that, totally. I mean, of course, there is normative economics there. And I said, if you have collective decision making, it's very good to look at what's normatively the best thing to do. However, I think that the preference themselves, that was my main point. I just wanted to make that clear, that these positive in the meaning of real preferences, have an impact on what you regulate. That's my main point. That's why you need to take them into account. You need some feedback in order to find out about it. It is not normatively the rule that you have to make your decision according to the perceptions. That, I think, we agree. That is not what I want to advocate. Last point, precaution. I think you're right, precaution is a topic that's very ill-defined. But the concept behind it is that regulatory agencies are allowed to do some kind of regulatory action in the face of uncertainty about causal effects and the extent of the causal effect. Now, this could, of course, invite regulators to be arbitrary and capricious, just as what you said before, because at any decision, there are some uncertainties, and you could actually regulate everything just because there is some uncertainty left. However, I think in the way that the European community in this Communication 2000 has interpreted it is that, well, if there is a clear suspicion, or if there is a clear possible link between, you know, a pollutant or whatever and an effect, but we don't have the clear evidence about the magnitude of this, but it could be high, you can still do something about it. And I think that's kind of a prudent behavior in a sense. And you know, there are a lot of comparison. Jonathan Weider did a comparison between the United States and Europe and found out that both systems work very often on precautionary measures. They just call it differently. And because you know, it's, you don't want to learn only by the facts and by you know, retroactively, you want to make sure that some of the things that might create a lot of trouble in the future at least are contained. And precaution is not equivalent to banning. I mean, it's not meaning that we ban everything, but there's a possibility within the precautionary principle, for example, to contain in space and time the hazard, or you have a very strong monitoring requirement to make sure that, you know, in the end, decisions can be reversed. I think that is the asset of precaution, that you can revert decisions once you find out that the consequences are worse than you had expected.
Can I just follow that up with a bit of a tangent? It strikes me that when something is already prescribed by law and regulators have limits that they are meant to implement or not, it's fairly clear cut. They need some evidence, and if, for example, there's a risk that exceeds the tolerance, it's banned. That seems to be pretty clear cut, and there's no precaution about it. It's just applying their mandate. What we seem to be talking about with one or two things now, and GMs is the one that we've tabled here, one could perhaps raise other equally interesting technologies such as electromagnetic fields or nanotechnology or synthetic biology. What we seem to be dealing with there is something where there is no regulatory framework, or there's a lack of appropriate regulatory framework. In nano, it's arguable that there are plenty, but they're not called nanotechnology. And that a decision to apply anything precautionary is actually not regulatory at all, it's political. And delay on the lay the blame for a precautionary approach to a new technology where there's no mandate strikes me as being a bit unfair on the regulators who have a specific job to do. John, how do you see that?
Just a quick clarification. The U.S. government has never had any problem with the word precaution. In fact, it is embedded in U.S. food and environmental law. That's not the issue. The issue is the word the and principle on the two. And we believe that we have yet to get a clear explanation on what this singular, universally applicable principle is without regard to context or evidence or anything else. And until we get that answer, I don't think there's going to be any agreement on it. But the idea that you might want to, like, protect people from tobacco before you know exactly how many thousands of people are dying, we believe in precaution like that. And we wish, as a country, we had acted even earlier than we did to prevent it. And we note that there are some examples where Europeans have not acted as precautionary as they might, whether it be diesel engine exhaust or environmental tobacco smoke or lead in gasoline, and I could name a couple more. So precaution is not the issue.
Mm-hmm. May I suggest that something like joint fact-finding process, also what precautionary principle means in actual politics, would be perhaps a solution for that? Because I mean, if you really, if you state the case of GMO, I think that it's just a good example for not having had a joint fact-finding process where all the arguments were really transparent on the table, instead of a very intransparent decision process within the European Commission. Also, for their reasoning of their decisions, they also cite scientists, and it's just a matter of what kind of scientists and what kind of reasoning they choose. And I, as a consumer or as a citizen, I would, as I said, very much like to know how do they get to that conclusion, what kind of scientific evidence did they really apply. And there comes into the game also a role that you just mentioned, that administrations and politicians have, of course, self-interests. They want to show how strong they are in leadership. When a potential risk arises, they want to show that they are doing something, that they can implement something, so which might be completely conflictious to the evidence or to evidence-based policy making. So how do you deal also with those self-interests of administrations on politicians?
Well, just on that one, the EPA, if I understand it, was only able to treat car emissions as pollution because Massachusetts challenged its application of its mandate. Is that right, John? So is it really difficult for regulators themselves to extend their mandate?
I think the federal agencies are given broad discretion to interpret the language that our Congress places in those laws. But if they would make an interpretation that would be so indefensible that one could not imagine someone making that, then they do have the power, the courts have the power to overturn that. And that's what the Supreme Court did in the case of the EPA's decision not to include carbon dioxide as an air pollutant. They said that's not within the zone of a reasonable position. Mm-hmm. And if I remember right, was that the one that was 5-4 in the Supreme Court?
Yeah.
I believe it was 5-4. So yeah. I don't know how you can resolve that, but in any event.
Okay. We haven't heard from any of you yet. No one's come to the mic. Is there anyone? Peter is one. We've got it. Well, before, I've got another one here. How many more people would like to contribute? Can I ask the two of you, Peter first, and then gentleman here?
Okay.
If you could use the mic, that would be.
Okay. No, it's working. First of all, thank you very much for the interesting discussion. I would like to go back to the, I would say, to the heart of the discussion. This is about evidence and what evidence is. And my understanding so far is, I mean, there are two different views we already here saw. The first one is that evidence, in a way, you can, in a way, make a kind of hierarchy. You could say there's some evidence, scientific evidence, which is based, for instance, on meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials. So you say, put that on the top. And then you say on the bottom, maybe there is anecdotal evidence. So let's say here's a perceptions opinion on this. And if you have clear rules how to, in a way, make the distinction between the different kinds of evidence, you are, let's say, maybe on the you have some rules how to deal with different, with this conflicting evidence. But on the other side, if you don't have that and you start a negotiation process, you say, okay, we bring together the different views, the stakeholders, and all this different, let's say, with different views on the evidence, the different qualities of evidence, at the end, maybe you will have a consensus, but I mean, that might be a wrong consensus based on the kind of fuzzy evidence. Couldn't it possible?
Can we have the other question? And just whilst you're handing the microphone over, I would particularly like Ortvin and Hans Peter to give an insight into, because it's been said a number of times, the word consensus, which strikes me as being sort of something regulators will find very difficult to implement. If the objective is always consensus, doesn't there come a point where one actually will decide? But
I am an economist. I teach economics. My name is Pennisi. I've been working for a long time for the World Bank. Then I joined the Italian government. I had several senior positions in the government. Eventually, I decided that to teach is better than to work, you know. So I went to teach. Now, I've been working a long time on risk analysis. And I think I have a variety of views on evidence in risks. Let me quote two examples that could be quite extreme. First of all, when you work on developing countries on agriculture, it's very important to have the risk aversion factor of the farmers. Now, I remember in dealing with rural development projects in Africa, when you try to bring improvements through a technical package, a new technical package, even through a very simple technical package, normally the risk aversion of farmers is so high? Is it something that we have been able to get evidence about through surveys that you need an expected yield, which is about 5 to 6 times as high as the yields that they're used to? And this is quite comparatively simple, because you run a survey, could be costly. You run a comparative survey with 2-3 countries, you get a fix on it. Normally, FAO runs these kind of things quite regularly. Then you can find yourself, as we found ourselves in Italy some 20 years ago, by the time I was there. There was the Chernobyl problem. We had the ecological party, whatever, promoted a referendum. We had a referendum that was read as a no nuclear power referendum, against nuclear power, fine. We had a big power plant being constructed, big nuclear power plant being constructed, where we had a lot of sunk money, a lot of money had been invested. And really the issues was whether to convert it into a fuel plant, whether to convert it into, I don't know, a symphony hall or whatever, in the middle of nowhere, or something else, or whether to destroy it completely. Now, the reading by public opinion was that the referendum meant that a political cost-benefit analysis had been made, and that the result of the political cost-benefit analysis was no to nuclear power. Now, all of this was very much exaggerated, I mean, but that's how the perception was. At that point, we had to study a variety of alternatives, what to do with the investments. Eventually, the only way, it was impossible to get evidence on risk of a nuclear power plant. Now there, the problem you have, that the probability is very, very tiny, but if something happens, the damage, you know, very, very serious. There, eventually, we worked on counterfactual evidence, which is to say, assuming that you get some very new development, at the time in the UK they were experimenting with some very new protective device, and with some other experiments they were working on Finland, assuming that what would be the additional cost to bring that in, and around the cost benefit test through. I think, however, and I don't know whether I've been taking too much time by quoting two extreme examples, I think, however, that nowadays the real problem is strong, but you get something. But what do you do when you deal with uncertainty? Now, I think that what really something like your council should be working should be more on how to deal with uncertainty. I think that a major breakthrough was made in 1994 by Dixit and Pindick on the real option approach in dealing with uncertainty. I've been working on that. I've been working on that, and if I can mention a specific case, I don't know whether I have time. When we were asked, I was asked with a colleague to work on an issue where many countries are confronted with, which is what would be the cost of changeover from analogical television to digital video broadcasting terrestrial. Then you're dealing with really with uncertainty, because you're dealing with a service that nobody has seen, with a service that nobody, we don't know what the willingness to pay is, we don't know what, and so on and so forth. And there, by using options, and by running some comparatively simple questions, because we didn't have much money for contingent evaluation, running questionnaires among students, civil servants, and so very limited thing. We didn't have the money to run a proper thing. We got a fix on options.
Okay.
By getting the fix on options, you know, that could be really the way out also the precautionary principle, that as the principle, I don't like it at all, but as, you know, something to look into. Could
Thank
be very worthwhile.
Thank
so
you very much.
For too much time.
Altman, uncertainty and aversion.
Yes, well, thank you for your contribution. I think what you pointed out is very important, that uncertainty has different ingredients. And when we talk about uncertainty, we very often mean very different things. You talked about this aleatory uncertainty, which is basically, you know, Monte Carlo simulation and random events, which you can calculate if you have, you know, enough a number of ends. There's epistemic uncertainty, which is basically, you know, do all the extrapolation and do all these kind of inferences you need. We have system boundaries, which means that anytime you do some kind of calculation, you have to define your target, and you have to define your cost. And if there's something outside of your target or outside of your cost, you may miss something very important. Yeah. Some people have called that non-knowledge or whatever. But it's an important aspect, because very often if you set your boundaries, and you're bound to set boundaries. I mean, you cannot escape it. I mean, that's a very important element. So maybe you look for cancer, but maybe it's something else that this kind of agent is doing. And then we have the so-called indeterminacies, which are things where you don't see a causal relationship, but there's some kind of an association that you cannot explain. And that is kind of, it could be, you know, totally probabilistic or not, surprises, other kind of things that happen. Now, given these different elements of uncertainty, I think it really points out again that in terms of what evidence means, if we have a lot of these different uncertainties involved, we do not have one definite answer to a very important question. But we have a couple of potential answers that, you know, that all, you know, have the legitimacy, and it's, again, as John pointed out, it's then the decision maker who has to deal with it, and within decision making the different models and how to deal with different resolutions of uncertainty. However, that enters the field of ambiguity, which I said before, and that I think, and again I want to make that plea, that in that sense, then having some participatory processes, not in a sense of thinking that lay people have better evidence than the others, I think that's nonsense, but to see, you know, what kind of evidence in contesting evidence is really taking into account how precautious you want to be. And I agree that the principle, I think, is somehow misleading. But how precautious do you want to be? How much do you want to invest in, you know, being maybe too cautious? And how do you want to be invest in maybe not being cautious enough? And because it's uncertain, there's no scientific answer to make that distinction between cautious and not cautious enough. You may, you know, be against innovation if you do it, overdo it, or you may, you know, sacrificing public safety on the other hand. So, and that's where I think it's negotiated safety. That's where I believe negotiation has its place. Truth cannot be negotiated. That's, I think, your point. I mean, I cannot make a big a referendum whether 2 and 2 is 4 or 5. I mean, you know, even in terms of, you know, more contested factual knowledge, resolving conflicts in science is not done by vote. And a peer review is not a voting procedure, but is an agreement on the methodological rules that you can apply to come up with some kind of a conclusion. And I think we need to have that in place. I mean, anything else doesn't make sense. And joint fact finding does not mean we have a vote at the end whose claims is right and wrong. I think that would be the wrong vein. Joint fact finding really means that we try to assemble the claims that somehow are legitimate, and then try to see which of these kind of plural input to our knowledge can help us to make better decisions.
I'm going to be finishing in 6 or 7 minutes. Thank you. Hans-Peter, I'd like to know how much of the detail that we've been talking about for the last half, perhaps, of the discussion you're actually able to share during a participative process. One of the things that strikes me, and just in case anyone misinterprets what Peter said earlier, I'm not a scientist either. Public attention spans are described as getting ever shorter. Sound bites are getting shorter. It's difficult. I mean, there are two BBC journalists here. I bet they can't put 2 minutes of solid text spoken on the radio. Just if it's really good, okay.
But we don't qualify.
editorial pressure to splice and to change subject. How can you get this sort of detail into a participative process without people walking out the room?
People, it depends on what kind of people you have in the room, you know. First, if you have people who are somehow in the issue already, they won't leave because they are interested. Experts, they are also interested in going into the detail. But even citizens, we had some very good experiences also with having citizens coming together, spending weekends of their time just debating, for example, the future of brain research, what should the limits be, something which is really a very complicated issue. Of course, they needed some expert input, but the conclusions they with what they came out were very accepted also in the scientific world. So I think there is certainly an acceptance of all kinds of people to go into the detail. They know that we don't want to just superficially make a decision without having really evidence enough. So there is a willingness of all people. The only thing is they have to be asked, mm-hmm. and they want to really they want really to be listened to. And this is, I think, very important that we have leaders, that we have administration, regulatory bodies that really listens before they make the decision, and they make this listening also transparent.
Okay. John, final question before we ask everyone to wrap up. John, you spent a lot of your time at OMB going the other way. You had to go over the road and speak to people about what they, as leaders, had to do. What was their attention span like?
Whose?
The leaders.
Leaders of?
The president's office, for example. You would be going over to the White House and saying, this is what I advise. Now, how did you package that when it was scientific-based? Getting the evidence to them.
Right. I think that the people should understand that the executive office of the president in the United States is a very complicated and actually quite diverse group. You have people on, you have some people on the one hand who have a scientific and an economic orientation and who will be asking those kinds of questions. You have communications people who are just worried about the next news cycle. What does this mean in terms of the next news cycle? You have people who are interested in the politics and the president's political future. So I would be hard to generalize. We have to get down and talk about each of those specific groups and how it varied issue by issue. But I think in general, when it dealt with regulatory issues that involved health, safety, and the environment, I think that they would have liked to have thought that this was grounded in some actual evidence, and that we're not simply putting together a group of people who have opinions on the subject and seeing what they want to come up with. And I understand that some of these exercises are more sophisticated than that, but the more sophisticated they are, I think the more value they have. And I think in a local context where people might have the time and energy to put into these things and you can really identify all the key stakeholders, I think they may have a lot more value. It's harder for me to see it how it happens in kind of a national, and particularly as we move in the direction of transatlantic kind of rulemaking cooperation in various ways. I think we're going to have to appeal to more kind of analytic and scientific approaches. It's the only way that can pull us together.
So what strikes me is that there's a lot of stuff out there that's happening, and it's almost impossible for the regulatory machinery to keep up. Okay, I've said to the organizers I'd finish at 10 to 6 to allow you to struggle down in the lift to find your coats before the hotel bus. That gives us 3 minutes, which is going to be 1 minute for each of Ortwin, John, and Hans-Peter to give some final thoughts on the subject.
Yes, I'll start. Think about the 1 minute and it's over. What I would like to stress is, I think, three things. First, evidence is very important, is crucial for good decision making and for regulation. And it's very important that evidence is kept free of interests and value statements. Point two, that evidence is today more contested. It is more plural, but it's not arbitrary. We should cultivate a system in which the boundaries between the absurd, the possible, and the probable and the certain, that this, you know, that distinction is being made a major element for informing our policymakers. And a third one, notwithstanding the fact that this kind of evidence is absolutely necessary and true, it does not precondition the decision or the regulatory advice. For making prudent decisions, we also need knowledge about the perceptions and the values of people, and we also need to know what the trade-offs are that these people would make if they are well-informed.
Hans Peter.
Yeah, one last sentence. I would love to discuss further your last comment, because I don't, I doubt, to my opinion, that analytic or scientific approaches are a contradiction to participatory joint fact-finding. I think that both belongs together, and the question is how do we really get it together? And that is the task we can discuss afterwards at
yes,
a beer.
In the United States, if stakeholders have data and evidence, it just needs to meet the same standards as the OMB bulletin describes.
Sure. Yeah.
Replicable, et cetera. And if it meets those standards, it's just as good as anybody else's data and evidence.
Okay. I would also say, on the other hand, that has also to be true for the administration and for the bureaucracy and for commissions like the EU Commission or whoever, you know. So if we agree on that, that's fine.
Okay. Right. Well, I'm going to close the session at this point. Firstly, on behalf of the panel here, I'd like to thank you for being our audience and being so attentive to the discussion over the last 90 minutes. Then on behalf of you, the audience, I'd like to thank Ort van Ren, John Graham, and Hans Peter Meister for a discussion that took us to some uncharted areas. I've been slightly lucky in that I've talked with most of them before, and I therefore knew a bit about what was going on. But from my perspective, I think we've given good coverage to the fact that evidence is needed for risk and regulation, but in fact, we haven't really got to the point where we can provide it without some uncertainty. That's the dilemma that the regulatory process is in, and for the next day, the conference will continue to look at regulation, but I hope we've given a bit of an airing to the evidence problem. Thank you.